on to the next speaker. Next speaker is Mr. Andreas Horny. He will be speaking about the distributed ground station network, a global system for tracking and communication with small satellites as an open service.
First of all, I'm really glad that I can present our project here, so really nice opportunity here. I'm Andreas Hornig, and this study has been done at the IRS, at the Institute of Space Systems of the University of Stuttgart and other accompanying organizations. And first of all, we are one of these projects, the ITU representative told us about, but we are not transmitting anything to the outer space stuff. So we are just listening, so we are safe in this aspect. To give you a content about the presentation, I will give an overview of why we did this with our small satellite situation project. We'll give a short overview how other tracking and communication networks are doing this, with our proposed solution will be done, and go into detail about the pseudo engine we are currently applying, giving a short introduction about the architecture and the ground station and infrastructure, and some examples for the applications, and of course, perspective and conclusions. Okay, first of all, the basic ideas of the study are coming directly from the small satellite project we have been conducting last year with the University of the Azores. So we had an Earth observation project there, and we directly wanted to know after the injection into our orbit, because it was a piggyback launch, what orbit do we have, and what orbit did the launcher provide to us. So even for this concept, we wanted to have a secondary scientific payload, giving us the opportunity to directly, or in a closer time frame, giving us the direct orbit determination. So sometimes there is an uncertainty in the provided orbit, and we want to be clear to which direction our high-gain antennas are pointing directly for the commissioning of the satellite. So this had been part of this Verdesat, that was my project, and the infrastructure we wanted to have was as few ground stations as possible, so to reduce the infrastructure costs, but in this case it didn't work, so we had to rely on bigger ones, because we had the main terminals for communication in both directions, so we included, at least we wanted to track and listen to the beacon signal everywhere on Earth. Sometimes the existing stations are too good for small satellites, so this space network is not made for small satellites, and other projects and other communication tracking facilities are not even able to do it. And the minimum access time to the satellite, like I mentioned before, is sometimes 10 minutes in best cases. We wanted to extend at least for basic tracking issues. And the frequency allocation is one of the things we observed. We wanted to have a hand radio operator's license, and we have one at the Institute, but for the distributed ground station network, we don't want to send anything, so it should be just a listening mode to be safe here. Okay, tracking services, I think a lot of you know, there's NORAD filling the two-line elementary sets, and NORAD is also doing this, but these are active, at least from ground to space or vice versa directions, and they are regularly updating this, and for small satellites, sometimes it's not regularly enough. So we wanted to have a shorter period in between where the small satellite and CubeSat project and even NanoSats will get their orbit determination data. Communication services, like really going into the communication side, is Deep Space Network, of course, but not for small satellite and ASTRAC, but they are expensive to use sometimes, and of course they also have this regularly updating of the databases. And communication infrastructure in general, then you have to set up your own ones, so you have to have some money for it, and the Gentoo project, I think a lot of you know, but in this case they have to send out, and we didn't want to do this, so because everybody has to have a license for it, and we wanted to include really everybody, virtually anybody, and in this case anybody would have this license, and we can't do this, that's not possible, no, we don't support this. And our project is setting up a big grid of sensor nodes, just in listening mode. So for correlation, the first thing is correlation with the global navigation satellite services, so that we have a global distribution of time at each grid node. So this is important for the correlation of the reception time of the signal and to have the same time everywhere to get to our checking calculation later on. Then of course, when the signal is sent out, this has to be combined and so the checking is only possible then. This will be used on the bottom part there is, in case you are not in the provided in case you are not in the specified orbit but got another one, your high gain antenna isn't targeting to the expected direction, and if you know it earlier, then you have perhaps some time advantages that you are directly going into your target, or at least not for 2 weeks. And of course, if it's possible to have a beacon signal somewhere beeping all the time, at least some slight data about some bits or kilobits per second maximum can be sent. So that could be like the ID of the satellite plus temperature and basic data. And perhaps in case of more sophisticated antenna system, even more. But this is just the basic. You want to be safe and have a working concept for this. Okay, what we are doing is, okay, everybody should have done this during math courses in high school or even later for solving the Apollonius problems. The circles over there are only representing the 2Ds, and we are doing this in 3D, so we have to have at least 4 of them, and it's a basic reverse GPS approach. So instead of having 4 plus satellites going into your handheld device, you have a handheld beacon sending out a signal, and we will receive it at 5 plus stations, and the more there are, perhaps there are some accuracy increasement there that you can even filter out some bad results and can track the orbit determination really, really good. We have done a simulation for it with at least 15 stations. I will just start it here. On the bottom there are the 15 stations, and on the top the blue one is the expected version, and the green one is the calculated one. So we have 15 stations here, and in this case, when you are looking closely, there's one on the top part and one below the Earth or the ground station position. This is because we are using 4 stations there, and if you wait a second, like here, now it's filtering out the bad results. Later on, now it's using a lot of more. And in this case, it's an overdetermined system for doing this kind of sphere calculation. And then, okay, it's averaging the error, but still it's giving you good results. And then you don't have the results in the Earth center. If there is a result in the Earth center, then there's something wrong with your positioning or with the time synchronization. Okay. Next one. This is just one sample out of it. We have 2 approaches here, one combinatorial, so using 5 out of 15 stations and then combining it with each possible solution, or using an overdetermined system with 5 plus and doing the same, but this 5 plus you can have this averaging of error, and we wanted to check what's happening. So with about 8 ground stations in combination, the error is really, really bad, at least for this statistically just defined system, but the average one is at least in a better condition, like 50 meters or 200 meters range, but later on it's getting increasing the accuracy. With 15 stations there is about 2 meters accuracy, but it relates to the angle in between. So if you have an array of ground station with 100 kilometers distance in a box, this is done for this, then the 200 kilometers orbit is better than a higher one, because the angles in between all these lines you have seen is not so steep, and with steeper angles the accuracy goes down. So in this case, not in every case the number of ground station increases it, but with combinatorial in the means, you can filter out the bad results. I will show it later. Okay, giving you an impression of what we are doing. So we are the picture on the left side. So we have a mission control client, that could be you. You have your own antenna. You are doing the active control from your side. So you have to be sure that you have the license for everything. And the user side, the participant side on the right, the green ones, using somehow cheap antennas, and they don't send, they're just receiving, sending it to our central constellation server that's already running, but not for this issue, and the mission control client, and the person there is able to get it afterwards. So the only thing directly connecting you between the mission control and the grounds and the participants is outreach. Like, please help us. And the current finding is this, so there is no way of actively controlling their antenna system. The Gensler system is doing this by the mission client is directly connecting to the ground station server, and then you are controlling their system. So they have to be sure that both of them are able to and allowed to use it. So we are just listening to safe. And we are only going into listening mode. The users can be everybody. We want to have citizen science, so we have a cheap product, plug into the PCs worldwide, I will come to it later. And not only hand operators, so increasing the numbers that we have this global grid of communication system. And we want to have more active users, and it's a real citizen science and outreach project. So going directly to the people outside, not just the operators. Okay, regulation, like I said before, is amateur radio frequencies to be able to use it and even include it. Sometimes the radio amateur community is asked for some slide of their bandwidth, but they are just getting the data and have to hand it over, and they don't even know what they are doing there. So it's a little bit impolite, and we want to give them some results, so perhaps they are allowed to get some pictures or get some temperatures to be an active part and not just a receiver of something they don't know. And it's just reception only for the first phase. If you're going to another phase, we have to have a clear, like I said before, the ITU representative, we have to have a clear situation about it, so just listen now. The density, to give you an example, we did in system margin over elevation study with different frequencies in amateur radio frequency bands and with different data rates ranging from 0.5 kilobits to 2 kilobits, so that's not much, but sophisticated enough for us, and from 2.4 to 0.4 gigahertz, and we wanted to know how many grids we want. Which we need there, and at the end we took the 2.5 gigahertz because a lot of you want to have S-band with 2 kilobits to have at least some data rates, and in this case it's 365 stations worldwide, so there's a lot of water, we will just keep it on the ground side, and this looks much. If you are just estimating 200 euros per unit, then it's a lot of money, but there are projects like the Air Quality Act and other sensor community citizen science projects. They have like the Blitzautom is a flash detection service, has more than 1,000 active users building their own sensors. Okay, they're not using frequency bands for communication, but just detection. Okay, our hardware is just in prototyping stage, so I'm just leading to the sketches here. They are small devices. They should be attached to personal computers or somebody, something else with some computing power and internet connection. We want to have a modularity for extensions. So if you want to have other frequency bands, you just plug in another receiving card and get your ISM or whatever band, and or sensor something else like air quality in your home and send it back. And we want to have it open source. Like I said, we want to include everybody, so everybody should at least able to buy something, or if he's able to build it by itself, like soldering, he gets the blueprints, he can print it and start, construct it itself. The basic thing is, you get a signal from whatever satellite event, get it into the receiver, it's done into the bus connector, and in the time board, the GPS, 1 pulse per second, is done, is also multiplied with, in this case, it's just an example with 10 megahertz, so that you have in between some kind of steps, and it's latched until this signal event is also detected in the event detector, and then this time is collected, and then you can correlate the signal event to the reception date, or the reception time, and then you can say, okay, I want to do the reverse GPS and do at least soil ranging, so we are not doing phasing or frequency change, so it's just the first step, and we are currently building the time board. Okay, now after the hardware side, the infrastructure is already there. There is a citizen science project I do since 2010. It's a distributed computing platform using Boeing. Perhaps some of you know CT at home, so we're doing the same. So we are just calculating solving numerical aerospace problems. But if we have, in this case, 7,800 users worldwide with 2,300 active host PCs, so we don't need a custom computer, at least for our purposes. if you're just persuading them, 10% of them, please build your stuff, buy it, plug it to your PC, put the antenna on your balcony, then there's more than the needed 265 users out there in 108 countries currently. And the teraflops is also great, and we have it for basically nothing. We have some a lot of great users spending their idle time, so it's 24/7, not like Genso where we have to ask them, please put your stuff on. They are basically running all the time because they are getting credits, they are team competition, and they want to be included in this. So these are normal people like me. Okay, direct applications for this. So it's not just satellites, this was just a starting point. So this is also the things we want to do with our first testing is fox hunting. So not a real fox, somebody is hiding in a forest, has a beacon, and somebody is trying to get you. And yeah, in my community there's a lot of quadrocopter building currently going on. And ADS-B is another thing, because ADS-B is the air traffic control signal broadcasting, and they are really sending out their position, so we can use this position of the airplane, send it out to use it as the testing, if our calculated position to the sended one is correct. So these are the first thing. And at later steps, we want to have high altitude projects like weather balloons or the either Rexus Bexus. There's even a project who wants to use it on their balloon experiment team. It's Team Trader. And afterwards, perhaps you are interested, put it on a small satellite. At my institute, there's a flying laptop project. Okay, it's a bigger one, but there are even a lot of CubeSats. We asked Alusat, and they're really keen in getting to know more information about it and other projects. And I just mentioned the S-range over there, because we are doing this for the global grid, but if you are able to have it as open source, you can build your own, you can set up yourself an own measurement system. And for example, on B, there's an ice hotel. I would like to place at least one ground station there doing one campaign and then collecting the data afterwards, because there is no internet, so somebody has to stay there, just as an anecdote. Target group, okay, there's basically just a small and limited budget project like nano and small satellite with universities. Satellite constellations and swarms where it's difficult to distinguish between them, like QB50. Three entry vessels, that's also one topic, because I would like to know what kind of effects the re-entry thing, plasma effects, has on the on the calculation. High altitude experiments I already mentioned, like planes and drones, of course. Sensing platforms, you can attach everything to it and send it over air quality, if it's raining, like weather stations and so on. Or GNSS quality measuring, that has already been done by VARS and IGNOS, so perhaps you can extend it, because they already are included with GNSS, so why not using this? And that's my personal thing, safety of life. So if you're going skiing or snowboarding outside the protected areas, perhaps you can have a beaker, and like I said before, if you put the open source or just the ground station on the ridges on the summits of the mountains below there or in the area, perhaps there is at least a way to have the entry point into an avalanche, just as important. Open access is important because we are asking for help, so we don't want to close everything, so the participation should be open for everybody. There should be an open tracking database, so that directly when we have it, perhaps one day later, not 2 weeks later, we are setting up a database so everybody could connect to it. The optional thing is an open payload data, because if you are sending data to us, you want to have it first, perhaps want to have it for 1 year, so you decide what happens with the data, and you're using data dump mode. I would like to have it open, but it's your data. But the tracking, you could see in a satellite if you have an observation, so at least this should be open. And we want to have it as a fast and cost-efficient provision of data of two small projects, like at universities, and of course this is also everything as an open source project. Okay, everything could be connected like a creative way to extend the concept beyond satellites. So there is perhaps not the service market, but if you are able to build this, I'm a lazy guy, I can't do soldering, I would buy it if it's just 200 euros, I would buy it, put it in something in my fore garden, and then I'm fine. So there is at least some venue of it. And now I'm done, I hope I'm on time, and thank you for your question, and I would like to have you join to our network. So thank you.
Okay, I can already see one question.
Thank you very much for your excellent presentation. Oh, I'm very happy.
My English isn't so good, so this is you.
For me, it was the best presentation of today afternoon session. Personally for me, I have only one comment question. That information related to GENSO is, I think, no relevant, because for me, sorry to say, GENSO is dead. It was never ever in real operation, probably only on the paper, and that's why my question is, what you learn from the GENSO design project, because it was probably too ambitious, that your project is working? Because this I would like to know, that how you motivate these high thousand of voluntary users, because they are radio amateurs, they cannot receive money from you, nothing. That's why we have to say that this network is voluntary network. If you can say a little bit about how is the network working and what you learn from the GENSO design.
First, infrastructure on the network side, there are a lot of Boeing projects already, even with sensors. There is a Quake Catcher network. You can use, like in your iPhone, there are accelerometer. And in case something is wobbling in your area, they will detect it, send the data back, and with some magic math, I don't know, they can say if it's a real earthquake or not. There are 4,000 people just because they want to know if there is an earthquake nearby, and they have cheap hardware for it, and it's even in computers, and Mac and IBM have it included. They already have it, it's cheap, and they want to help others. So this is a basic need of citizen science. If it's cheap enough, and the purpose is good enough. So if you could provide perhaps one image a week and they can see some stars, I think you're already doing this. And okay, if it's not the green man, like some closed information, just share it. And this is the thing, there is a big community, and in my paper I described 5 of them, I think, and the expensive one was 200 euros. This was, I think, the Air Quality Act. It's a little sensor just for air quality. So if they put it here in Beijing, I think they have a real good purpose for it, and we are basically the same. A lot of people are interested in space, they would have, and they get competition. So the more the PC is running, they get more credits, and there are team challenges. We are already doing this. ZT at Home has 1.5 million users. Okay, and you have to buy an additional hardware, then it's less, but just 1.1% is good enough for us, at least for starting, and we do it anyway. Okay, and from the GENSO thing, I talked with a lot of amateur radio people, and they said, okay, I would do, but not 24/7, and if they crash something, I'm a strong supporter of it, but if something breaks, who pays? And in this case, it's only 200 euros, it's a simple antenna, no motor, nothing, perhaps not for the first stage, who knows what's in phase 10, if it's coming along someday, but it's cheap hardware. If it breaks, we build another one. There are soldering teams in a lot of hobby communities that do it all the time, it's cheap.
Okay, sorry, we need to hold it there, so thank you very much for your attention. Okay, that brings us to the next presentation by Bei Chow on research on small satellite formation, intersatellite measurement, and collaborative control.